Ago.
Amen.
Ago.
Amen.
Ago.
Amen.
All right, we are very pleased today to have visiting Professor Aram Ziai, representing University of Kassel here with us. And we also have our very own honorable, distinguished, and praiseworthy director here in the flesh. And as I was doing the write-up for the email that we sent out to promote, I came to realize that Professor Akosua Adomako Ampofo has a Master of Science in Development Planning. That in addition to being a gender specialist and an architectural engineer, so every single day I'm learning something new about our home director. So because she has a background in development, I saw that she is very much she has a background to deal with this as we are dealing with our development and political economy and things of that nature. So with no further ado, I'll turn it over to our chair, our very own distinguished, honorable, and praiseworthy Professor Akosua Adomako Ampofo the First. She in turn is the last. And she in turn will introduce our speaker for today.
Thank you very much, honorable, esteemed, and praiseworthy, I have to make one correction. I'm not an architectural engineer. I have a bachelor's degree in architecture. There's a very vast difference between having a degree in something and being something. This morning, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce to you Professor Aram Ziai, who is a professor at the University of Kassel from the Center for, it's not up there. Department of Development and Post-colonial Studies. Obviously, his location makes him a fitting presenter for this morning's topic. But beyond the location, let me say that we've worked together briefly for the last year on a joint collaboration that looks at issues of post-colonial and post-development, and I know the issue of post-development is, not everybody here is familiar with that term, or probably with the term, but know what the term involves, and certainly that's a part of the presentation this morning. The students are not here, so I know that I'm preaching probably to the choir to a certain extent, but issues of development are such a heavy part of our discourse in this country. We have a colleague at ESET who doesn't allow certain terms in their classroom events. A number of jargons that we throw around in this country, stakeholder, empowerment, development, and we don't unpack them or interrogate what they mean. And development is one of those terms. So this morning, I'm very pleased to be able to have share with us someone who has worked a lot on issues of post-development and to interrogate, tear apart, I don't know whether put back together notions of development and what does all of this mean for us. So we're very pleased to have you. Welcome. And these are mainly colleagues from the Institute and some others. I know that people will trickle in as you have experienced the UNSO since you came, so you know that it's also affecting people's ability to come to work. So thank you very much and welcome.
Thanks very much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thanks very much. It's very much Babele for the friendly invitation and the possibility to speak here at the Institute of African Studies. I really feel honored. I will try not to overstretch your patience with my talk today. In case I do, please alert me through snoring, falling asleep, or whatever. My topic today is, I'm afraid, not in the first place post-development, so you will have to invite me for another lecture sometime. But my topic today has to do with development studies, and specifically with international political economy. International political economy usually being the domain of hard facts, numbers, economic factors, and having very little to do with the area of representations and culture, and I think this is a deficit. So my today's talk is entitled Welcome to Zhengistan, Why International Political Economy Needs Postcolonial Studies. So my central question today will be, how could the study of international political economy be enriched by the perspective or the perspectives of postcolonial studies? And another central question is, where in the world is Zhengistan actually? So this Zhengistan story is of course a teaser to draw you into the lecture hall and to make you curious, and this is why I'm going to start with it right away. Now, I will talk about what are postcolonial studies, why they're necessary, about some specific postcolonial concepts, and then I will engage in what I've dubbed applied postcolonialism, so applying postcolonial concepts to the study of international political economy. Now, so where is Zhengistan? I assume that you don't know this gentleman here. This is, in fact, Zheng He, a Chinese mariner, admiral, and explorer. I'm sure I mispronounced his name, but I call him Zheng He, or Zheng He, probably. Now, he undertook, actually comparable to Christopher Colomb, 7 multi-year voyages all across the seas to India, Arabia, and Africa. And in his memoirs, he said, "We have traversed more than 100,000 li of immense water spaces and have beheld in the ocean huge waves like mountain rising sky high. We have set eyes on barbarian regions far away." Now, at that stage, I've been asking myself, what if one of these barbarian regions far away would have been the region where my mother has been born? Now, starting with the historical facts, you'll see that these are the voyages he undertook, and basically they led him from China down to Indonesia, then up again to India, then further west, even to Arabia, to Mecca, and to East Africa, Mogadishu and Mombasa. Now, what I've been asking myself was, and at this point I will actually delete the microphone, what if he had, instead of circling the continents clockwise, what if he had done so counterclockwise? Because at that stage he would have at some point arrived somewhere here. Now, and let us assume that for some reason he might have gotten the idea that this western end of the continent might be a continent by itself. And let us further assume that because Zheng He was actually trying to find the passage to Ethiopia, he was assuming that the people living in this region were Ethiopians. Let us further assume that because this continent had been discovered by Zheng He, it went down to history as the continent of Zhengistan. Now, as absurd as it might seem, we all know that this is actually what happened, not with this continent, but with another continent. And we all know that this continent, which is not called Zhengistan, but might be, is actually called Europe. And that the continent of America, or the Americas, have been named after a Portuguese mariner. And that the people living there have been called Indians because Colón was assumed to be an Indian. Now this absurd constellation is now something very familiar to us. Now, remaining with these two continents, if one assumes Europe is a continent on its own, and including Eastern Europe, basically covers the area designated here in black, and if one compares it to South America, now there's a trick question. If Europe's landmass, as depicted here, is about 9.7 million square kilometers, what is then the landmass of South America? Guess. Europe, 9.7 million square kilometers, South America. You can try to.
It looks smaller.
looks smaller, so about
7.
Yeah, but in fact it's 17.8. One wouldn't guess if one looks at this map. Now, because this map is the usual map, the Mercator projection, which has been used since the 16th century. It heavily distorts the actual size of the continents. The actual size of the continents are reflected in the Peters projection. Then the continents would look like this. Now, especially have a look at the relation between Scandinavia and India in size, or even better, Greenland and Africa. So, a major difference. Now, why is it that we have been using these maps all the time, although they are so heavily distorting the proportions? Now, there are some historical answers, and it is, in fact, true that it's difficult to project a sphere onto a two-dimensional plane. Yet, nevertheless, there is the element involved that people tend, of course, to portray their own country, their own continent, as a little bit bigger, or even as several times bigger. Now, even in this projection, even in the Peters projection, as you see it here, Europe is still on top and in the middle. But of course, one could depict the world also in this way. One rarely does, but if you're looking for Europe, it's somewhere in the right corner down. Now, what is all this to do with the topic? Because my claim is that this is an example that our knowledge and our representations of the world are being influenced by the historical context, and this historical context for the past 500 years has, not exclusively, but mainly been the era of colonialism. And even long after formal decolonization, our knowledge and our representations are still formed by it, influenced by it. If I say our representations, I mean primarily people in Europe, but, well, to a certain extent, you will encounter representations like this also in other continents. Now, post-colonial studies are examining these effects of colonialism, and since the 1980s have been an increasingly recognized research perspective, at least in the Anglo-Saxon academia. Of course, there have been forerunners in anti-colonial movements, and many of these interesting arguments you will find in post-colonial studies have been already voiced by Aimé Césaire, Frantz Fanon, and others. Now, why are post-colonial studies necessary? One might argue, okay, but nowadays, well, equality of races is being, of course, recognized by all but some really right-wing fascist extremists. Now, it is necessary, I would argue, because we still find traces of colonial thinking. And one person to illustrate this has been Nicolas Sarkozy a few years back, who has given a lecture in the Cheikh Anta Diop University in Dakar. And in this lecture, he was addressing the African youth. And to the African youth, he was actually saying that the problem with Africa is that Africa has not fully entered history, but is caught in the ever-repeating cycle of seasons, in a repetition of the same practices and gestures since ancient times. Now, basically, this argument could date back to colonialism, has been called by Hegel as the argument that Africa has no history and that Africa is populated by the people without history. We all know what to think of it, and many in Dakar also did and were furious, but he himself didn't really seem to notice what he had just said. And he went on, it gets even better, and he went on to say, well, of course, colonialism wasn't such a nice thing after all. And he even said, well, we have done things wrong. But, he said, there was a good thing about colonialism, and the good thing was that Europe and Africa came into contact, and that this intercultural contact resulted in some European ideals, namely rationality and liberty, well, had been bequeathed upon Africa, and the African youth in particular. So basically, colonizers now claiming that the European heritage of rationality, liberty, and equality is something that African youth should turn to. Now, we also find examples of colonial thinking, not even with politicians, but also with political scientists. Two examples I would like to mention are two professors from Germany, actually famous professors. One of them is called Herfried Münkler, and 10 years back he wrote a book called New Wars, basically a sort of a copy of the Mary Caldor story, who also wrote a book about New Wars 2 years earlier. And in this book he contrasts two types of warfare. And he says, one type of warfare was the type of warfare used by European states between the 17th and the 20th century, a type of warfare which had rigid rules, so there was a clear separation between civilians and combatants. There was a clear beginning of the war, declaration of war, and at the end there was a peace treaty. There was a front where there was fighting, and there was an hinterland which was calm. And he says, in these new wars, which take place coincidentally not in Europe, but mainly in Africa, somewhere else in the world, you don't have these clear separations and these clear demarcations. And above all, you do not have separation between civilians and combatants. Whereas, you would argue, in the European state wars, mainly the victims of war have been combatants, soldiers. In these new wars, the main victims of these wars have been civilians. And he also argues that one major trait of these new wars have been massacres. That basically these civilians have been massacred, raped, mutilated, etc. So what he does is he constructs a dichotomy between civilized European state wars and barbaric massacres in the new war in the global south. Now, he seems to forget not only the experience of the world wars, World War I and II, where there were, of course, massacres of civilians on an unprecedented scale, but he also seems to forget the entire colonial wars that have been led, of course, using massacres, using rapes, etc., etc., mutilations as well. So it is actually not quite, well, understandable, apart from the argument that basically he is reiterating a colonial trope, the colonial idea of we are being civilized, you are not, and of course, well, we are even then civilized if we use massacres. A second example I would like to give is another political scientist called Ulrich Menzel, and he is very concerned with crisis regions. And he says, in order to deal with these crisis regions, we need protectorates. He doesn't call them colonies, of course, he calls them protectorates, and these protectorates should be supervised not by the United Nations, he argues, because in the United Nations, there are, of course, representatives of southern states as well, and as we all know, politicians of these southern states are all corrupt, and therefore, these protectorates should be guided, supervised by the OECD and the states of the north. So, what he is reiterating here is the notion of trusteeship. Basically, the democratic states of the north have to look after the non-democratic states of the south, the crisis regions of the south, for their own good, of course. Now, post-colonial studies are now trying to unearth these colonial elements in contemporary thinking. And whereas post-colonial studies have often been seen as complicated, unnecessarily complicated, I would argue that there are some post-colonial concepts which are very useful for the analysis of the international political economy, to which I will come in the last part of my lecture. But what are now these post-colonial concepts? I will just briefly present some of them. The first is Orientalism by Edward Said. Now, Edward Said is professor of literary studies, and in looking at the literature, at the European classical literature of the 18th, 19th, 20th century, he argues that basically throughout these centuries, in the novels of Britain and France, there have been repeatedly the same representations of the Orient. And he argues that these representations of the Orient are actually more concerned with the imaginary and the fantasy of the West than with the actual reality of the East. Now, he would argue that the idea, the figure of the exotic, mysterious East or Oriental despotism has, well, some grounding in reality, but of course there have been other instances which are then neglected in these representations, in the stereotypical representation of the Orient. And he describes the practice of othering, and by this he means the discursive constitution of one group as other, other than oneself. And he links this production of the Oriental other to the constitution of the self. So, by describing the Orient as less democratic, less secular, less rational, etc., it is implied that the self is, in fact, democratic, rational, and this is the only form of rationality and democracy that there is. Now, turning to the second one, Gertrude Spivak, she is dealing with the issue of subaltern representation, and the instance she discusses is the practice of widow burning in British India, which has been outlawed by the British colonizers in the 19th century already. And now what Spivak is arguing that basically, of course, the British colonizers assumed that they were saving Indian women from the barbaric cultural traditions practiced by Indian men. And she describes this as, with the phrase, we have an instance of white men saving brown women from brown men. Now, what Spivak would argue that basically in the historical record, we find the British colonizers arguing against widow burning, we find Indian men arguing for the upholding of cultural traditions, but we do not find anywhere the articulation of Indian women, of Indian widows, what they themselves thought. And Spivak goes on to argue, well, even if we did, we have a situation where any articulation of these women would have been co-opted either by the one side or by the other side, by the side of the British colonizers. If the women were against widow burning, the British colonizers would have adopted this argument as, well, an instance of proof for the superiority of European culture and the inferiority of Indian culture. Or, if they were skeptical about the ideas of the British colonizers, they were co-opted by the Indian patriarchy as an argument for the upholding of cultural traditions, no matter what the damn British say. So she argues that the subaltern Indian woman has been caught between these two discourses, neither of which actually represents the interests of these women. Now, there's a materialist footnote to this whole conflict about widow burning, which is very interesting. Because, as a matter of fact, although the debate was, of course, about culture, about tradition, about practices unrelated to, well, material matters at first sight. But Spivak, in fact, traces the origin of this practice of widow burning to a specific region in India where the laws of inheritance were slightly different from the rest. Namely, those regions where the widow would actually inherit all the wealth of her husband if she stayed alive. Now, this means that all these cultural debates have been taking place in a context which was in fact concerned with material interest as well, namely the material interest of the rest of the family to convince the good, pious, obedient, loyal woman to go and join her husband on the funeral pyre because they would get material rewards from this. one, call me Baba. Also, someone from literary studies. I have to admit, his style of writing is also sometimes exhausting for me, but I found some of his chapters really, really interesting. And the one I liked most was that about science taken for wonders, where he recounts the story he found of an Indian catechist, a missionary, Christian missionary, who encountered a group of converted Indians converted to Christianity in front of the gates of Delhi in 1815. Now, he knew that a few years back, the British had translated and distributed the Holy Bible and distributed it in Indian cities in order to, with the declared intention, well, to not only to enlighten and civilize the Indians, to bring them the right faith, but also to stabilize the rule of British India. Now, so when this Indian catechist encounters the converted Christians, he's actually very happy and says, "Oh, brothers, I greet you in the name of God. I'm so glad that you have found the way to Jesus." And they replied, "Oh yes, praise the Lord." And he went on to say, "Oh, and by the way, you know that we have to be thankful to the British, for they brought us the Holy Script that you are reading, and they brought us the right faith." To which the Indians replied, "What? The British bringing us the Word of God? No way." And what they said was, "The Word of God can never come from the flesh-eating mouth of the British." So it turned out that within a few years they had developed their own version of Christianity, a version which was, of course, based on vegetarianism, well, which is deeply embedded in the culture they belong to. Now, the interesting thing is that here, Homi Baba wants us to focus not on the power of ruling discourses, but on their instability and on the agency of the oppressed. Of course, the British had a decisive influence in India, and of course the distribution of Bibles had effects on the colonized society, but these effects were not always those that the British had intended. And these non-intentional effects are actually very interesting. And his notion of hybridity denotes not merely intercultural exchange. It is an asymmetrical exchange that we have here. The British are in the dominant position, but even those in the less dominant position exert agency and are sometimes even able to subvert the intentions of the colonizers. Now, mainly by here in this example, inscribing their own cultural practice into the dominant practice of Christian faith and thus changing it, subverting it to their own ends. Now, Baba then argues that this agency of the oppressed is not always outright resistance, but maybe the subversive appropriation of discourses and, here in this case, the creation of an Indian Christianity, which does not necessarily stabilize British rule in India. Now, there's also a materialist footnote here in this case, because if you have a look at it, in comparison to the Indian caste system, of course, Christian faith has represented a unique opportunity for lower castes to converge to a faith which does declare that before God all are equal. Now here, the motive to convert to Christianity may not merely have been the conviction that this is the right faith, but it also had the side effect of, well, escaping from a position of, well, political subordination in the Indian caste system. Okay, the last two I will deal with a little bit quicker, hopefully. Dipesh Chakrabarty has coined the nice phrase that we need to provincialize Europe. And by this he means that we need to rob Europe of the status of universality. We need to get rid of the idea that concepts which have been coined by Europeans for Europeans are in fact universal. And he says that investigating the Eurocentric origin of allegedly universal concepts is something which can prove to be politically useful. Because these Eurocentric concepts may be very useful, he says. He's very convinced that the works of Marx are very extremely useful, even though they may derive from this Eurocentric origin. But these Eurocentric concepts, he argues, might also have some constraints, might also be not quite fitting for the situation in other societies, other contexts. And he says we need, by provincializing Europe, we need to explore these constraints and we need to explore the possible alternatives to these European concepts. The last one I wanted to mention was Stuart Hall, who has written this brilliant article about Europe discovering America and basically constituting the other in the transatlantic relationships. And he argues, as I have described already in the context of Said's Orientalism, he argues that the Western identity was constituted in distinction to a non-Western other, which was constructed as inferior. And now the important part is that these constructions of identity are not merely matters of culture which have little relevance for material relations and power relations, but they are always connected to political claims. Because they are less democratic, it is our duty to rule over them in the very basic, simple form. And what he also describes is the stereotypical dualism of colonial discourses. So it is not only the case that the other has always been described as barbarian, inferior, and having no soul, as we have discussed a few days ago, but sometimes it has always, this colonial discourse has also constructed the image of the noble savage. And Hall illustrates this with the stereotypical dualism in the first contacts between Europe and America in the 16th century, where the Europeans described the division between Caribs and Arawaks. The Caribs were fierce, warlike, even cannibals, and were extremely dangerous. And so the best thing to do if you see a Carib is just shoot him. Now the Arawaks were the complete opposite. They were close to nature, they were peaceful, friendly, understanding, etc., etc. Now, if you have a closer look at the historical documents, you will realize that in fact, these were not two different tribes as the Europeans claimed that they were, but basically these were names, designations, given by the Europeans to those accepting European superiority, dominance, colonialism, and those rejecting it. And even those descriptions of the Caribs being cannibals are actually, well, not entirely fiction, but for the most part based on hearsay, based on, well, we have been told, and based on some rituals where, as a gesture of honor, some tribes have in fact some rituals of eating the heart of someone else. But the practice of eating man flesh, as in cannibalism, has actually been an invention of European colonizers. Now, these post-colonial concepts, this was the second part, have been criticized, of course. 10 minutes. Oh, now it's getting tough. Okay, I'm going to rush through these.
Yes.
So, basically, the criticism I would like to focus on is that these post-colonial studies originating in literary studies have been removed from the realities and struggles in the South neglecting material issues, neglecting material inequality. And in the examples that I would like to give, this has not been the case. There have been some post-colonial intellectuals have been using these concepts of post-colonial studies to make their point in the context of international political economy, and I would say in a very, very useful way. Now, the first example concerns child labor and human rights in the carpet industry, mainly in India. So, we have in this debate about child labor a conflict between the universalist position, which sees child labor as a violation of human rights, which has to be sanctioned and abolished, and the cultural relativist saying, okay, no, but in the Indian context, child labor has always been a part of this culture, and so it would be wrong to sanction it, and it is also very necessary for the families concerned. Now, this political scientist, Miriam Weiner, is also quite explicit in citing not economic but cultural reasons for the prevalence of child labor in India. Now, this can be, from the post-colonial perspective, identified as again some instance of othering. So, the Indians are, well, somehow backwards, somehow they don't see that it is bad for children to work 12 to 14 hours a day in the carpet industry, and they have to be saved by the enlightened West. Now, the post-colonial academic Geeta Chaudhry has pointed out that both the universalist and the relativist position are, in this debate, complicit with either the global or with national capital. She shows that the universalist position in the public debate in the United States has been, well, very concerned with human rights violations by Indian carpet manufacturers, but not by US companies profiting from these Indian carpet manufacturers, importing these carpets manufactured by child labor, and have in this case been, well, distracting from the responsibility that US importers have actually been the question of child labor. Whereas, of course, the other part, the cultural relativist position, is a position which has been aggressively promoted by the Association of Carpet Manufacturers in India, which is also, well, of course one could talk about working relations, the decent work conditions that would be possible and that are being denied by the carpet manufacturers in India. And both positions have also been employing what has been described as a reified and homogenizing conception of culture. The universalist position has been arguing, okay, well, in Indian culture there's this problem, regardless of the fact that there may be differing positions in India. And the relativist position has also been arguing, well, here in India, well, we have different cultural practices, we are actually, well, we're dependent also on child labor and we cannot afford to implement these Western standards, but they have been seen as Western standards. Now, this neglects the fact that this neglects the voice of the subaltern. Just like the voices of the widows in India have not been heard in this debate, the voices of the child laborers here in the carpet industry have also not been heard in this debate. And the voices actually exist. There are child labor unions, child labor activists. And one of them in the 90s has even been shot, a 12-year-old boy, been shot by, well, agents of the carpet manufacturer industry. And if you actually talk to now these child labor activists, you find that there is no homogeneous voice, because some of them are actually arguing for the abolishment, arguing, saying, yes, we would rather go to school than just here, toil here in the carpet industry. Whereas the other part of the child laborers actually say, well, labor is tough, but actually it's okay, but we need better working conditions. We need the right to unionize, etc., etc., things like that. So even here, there is no homogeneous voice within Indian culture. And looking at the representation in the West, we find that although NGOs have been, well, have been quoted in the media frequently, it's been Western NGOs. It has not been the child labor activists from India. So again, the voice of the subaltern is not being heard here. So I have two more examples. How many minutes do I have? Five, okay. I'll skip the second one, which is a pity, and I'll go to the third one, which is dealing with the Asian crisis. The Asian crisis of 1997-98. During the frequent prevalence of financial crisis, one maybe might have already forgotten, but at that time it was a severe incidence in the whole of Asia. We have here the graph with the exchange rates of some Asian currencies against the US dollar, and of course it's only a graph, but one can imagine what this might have meant for an economy and for a population if the exchange rates go down like this within a few days or weeks. Now, post-colonial academic Lily Lin is arguing that we have an instance of the West versus the rest, even here in the middle of the Asian crisis, even in, well, in an area populated by number crunchers and economic facts, we still find these cultural representations very vividly. And the backdrop of the crisis, she says, has been the steep rise of the East Asian tigers and their developmental states pursuing a very aggressive policy of catching up. And what is interesting, that this policy of catching up, of industrialization, has been framed with images which are extremely gendered. Developmentalism has been a form of patriotic manhood, which can be seen in images like the trade war, or even the calls, these are quotes from Korean government, the calls for total export war. Let's fight to build. We have to export for our nation to survive. Things like that. Images from war, from, yeah, basically, they've been talking about trade soldiers, industrial soldiers, expert soldiers, all along. And these images are, images of a patriotic manhood. Now, in the instance of the Asian crisis, Lily Ling sees that this patriotic manhood has been, well, disciplined by the Western masculinity. Disciplined or even emasculated. Because in the course of this Asian crisis, as a condition of the loans given by the IMF, there has been a disciplining of Asian capital. Basically, whereas foreign investors had been outlawed in Korean state companies before that, now the IMF made it a condition that these companies be privatized and sold not to merely private investors, but to foreign private investors. And this was the instance in the late 90s where foreign investors like Renault, Ford Motor Company or others have been taking over large parts of Daewoo, Samsung, Mitsubishi, so the great chaebols of Korea are now being, to a significant part, owned by US and European companies. Now, in the representation of the crisis in the media, we find these images which are still resonant with some colonial metaphors. The Asian economic crisis, the problem of contagion that has been repeated over and over again, reminds us of the sick man of Asia. The Asian other is the source of the problem, not Western capital flowing in and out in an uncontrolled manner is the problem, but, well, the Asian other needs therapy and cure from the Western doctors of the IMF. The immediate causes, crony capitalism, macro mismanagement, poor governance, the poor governance and the crony capitalism reminding us of these tropes of Oriental despotism. You know, the Asians, they are not as democratic as we are, so they're still a bit backward, we have to teach them. The Asians being too secretive and circumspect, aspect also repeats the idea that basically their cultural codes are not as they should be, not as they are in the West, and again, we have to teach them. So here we find all these invocations of colonial metaphors in the Financial Times, in The Economist, in the midst of an international political economy debate, which is supposedly objective, neutral, and scientific. Now, I won't have time to go into these points. I will close with the admittedly not very surprising conclusion that I draw, that postcolonial perspectives can in fact enrich the study of international political economy by pointing out Eurocentric and colonial patterns of representation. And this is the crucial point, their entanglement with economic factors and material interests. I thank you for your attention.
Very appreciative. Thank you very much for your seminar this morning, your contribution towards things that we do in this institute. I know there are many of our students who say they use post-colonial theory, and then the literature sometimes causes us to be a little uncertain whether it's actually post-colonial theorizing. So I think this is helpful to a number of our students. So the floor is open. Questions, comments, critiques, arguments, anything that you want to pose to our speaker?
He is in Tanzania.
I was wondering, as I listened to the presentation, I was wondering, did you consider, like, remember Ani's research in her book, Rubu, and everything said in her critique of European cultural thought and behavior, which, among other concepts, addresses the idea of Eurocentric universalism and the idea of cultural other. When you were formulating your own research as
He also typed it so I can read it more slowly. He asked, did you consider Dr. Marimba Ani's research in Yorubu, in her book Yorubu, an African-centered critique of European cultural thought and behavior, which, among other concepts, addresses Eurocentric universalism and the idea of the cultural other, formulated in your own research, which traverses much of the same terrain? All right, so Dr. Dukuzu Murengi, we thank you. Asante sana.
Thank you very much. So I'm Kaisa Hobbegu from the Institute of African Studies. So I thought this presentation was very interesting, and I think for the IMF example, we have a recent example here in Ghana, and I think we would find very interesting to follow the debates here locally. But my question is, and maybe you've covered that, you had a slide called Criticisms, which you didn't have really time to go into, so maybe you covered it there, but maybe like a problem that I see with postcolonial studies, and Professor Adomako Ampofo was alluding to that a bit, is again, we have to learn from Europe, because these are not things that we really talked about here. And you hear a lot of course, colonial thinking being alive and well in Africa. Where else? I mean, this, people tell me all the time, I mean, you're white, so you do this in a better way, or you're a foreigner, so you're not live. Things like this is alive and well here, but then the answer is the post-colonial thinking, which is again formulated outside of the continent. So this is a confusing part of post-colonial thinking, which I think we need to address.
And my question, I want to first give my appreciation for the presentation. My question is, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, who this building is also named after, he has a book called Neocolonialism, The Last Stage of Imperialism. And my question to you is, first, is neocolonialism, or was it something that existed, and is it before, during, or after post-colonialism? How can those two concepts be reconciled? And that neocolonialism basically deals with the continued colonial experience, and post-colonialism kind of deals with, like, that's something that was in the past and now we're into something else. So if you can help reconcile those two concepts, especially in terms of time, which one precedes the other.
So, answering the first question, I have to admit I'm afraid I did not consider this book. I would like to have the reference. You said you have it in written. This sounds very interesting, and I'd be happy to learn from this book. The second question. Well, the problem again being that here post-colonial studies proposes learning from the outside to Africans. Now, I would agree only partly. I mean, of course, what I've been presenting here has been only a very small part of post-colonial literature, and it is the part of post-colonial literature that I am most familiar with. But this is, of course, not a representative study, but the fact is that within African studies you have found, I'm sure, many post-colonial writers, or writers who are actually articulating very, very similar ideas. I mean, you have Valentin Mudimbe, you have Kalam Tonji, and you have some others which could be standing here in the slides in the very same place. It is merely the fact that I am less familiar with those, and therefore I was disinclined to quote them, because I know that here are some experts on these authors who know a lot more about them than I do. But I would not say that postcolonial studies are something that are, again, coming from outside. But I would say that basically postcolonial studies is now a name given to a current of thought which can also be found in Africa. As I said, which can be found already with Aimé Césaire, Léopold Senghor, Frantz Fanon, and this has been also one of the criticisms. It has been called postcolonial studies only when some of went to Harvard and got professorships in Harvard, Yale, and then it was the new big thing, and then it was called postcolonial studies. So this is the point of criticism I would basically agree to. Now, coming to the third point, Kwame Nkrumah's neocolonialism. Fortunately, I have read this one, at least. And the way I see postcolonialism, the word's been used in two senses. The one sense being a chronological sense. Postcolonialism is an era after the formal end of colonialism. And the other is more or less a conceptual sense. Postcolonialism as an approach, not as an era, but as basically an approach willing to examine the aftermath of colonialism. And therefore, in this sense, I would not see a, it has to be necessarily an era. How does it relate to neocolonialism? And if we look at the definition of neocolonialism, we see that many things, basically the dominance of Western corporations from former colonial countries in the South, in the former colonies, where this is something that we occur on a day-to-day basis. We still live in an era of neocolonialism. The thing is that basically there are others who would say, no, it's not an era of neocolonialism, it's an era of globalization. But basically they're talking about a very similar thing. So that would be my answer.
And I would suggest, I don't know if you need that, when we use neocolonialism or postcolonialism conceptually, there is an important relationship with debates on post-development, because we are critiquing a way of operating today that marginalizes, subjugates, keeps us in our place. So we use these concepts as a way of critiquing and contesting. Anyway.
Thank you very kindly for your presentation. I've got a two-part question here, and hopefully I can do noting on discursive consciousness and also practical consciousness, if we look at our Eurocentricity as a thesis and Afrocentricity as a synthesis, where do we place post-coloniality? Is it a synthesis? If it is, does it have eccentricity? That is the first question. The second question is that Ghana just signed, I think, an agreement with the IMF, and you just talked about the Asian crisis, and I believe there are African crises in the same vein. And the measures have always been devaluation of currency, okay? And then we have commodity pricing as we're looking at political economy. We also have what I call investment finance management if you are going to change your economy to develop. What do we need, because most of these measures will come from the IMF or the World Bank. And if we're dealing with post-coloniality, what do we have to counter some of these measures? Thank you.
Yes, okay. Thanks for this presentation. I think it was helpful in that it really brought these concepts down to an empirical level and used them as lenses. So I think that's really important. But I would like to maybe react to Kaiser's question about how external is it. And I just want to throw in this idea that, as you've been saying, this is a rubric, a name, a label, has been given to a tradition of thought that is way older than the label. And I think it's also much more rooted here, specifically here in Ghana, where we had all the Gold Coast nationalists debating some of the finer points of you know, what is now called post-colonial strategies and theorizing. And I specifically want to point to Kwekulabi Kurang's Writing Ghana, Imagining Africa, or the other way around. In any case, it's a book from 2004 in which he investigates you know, this tradition of theorizing and of agitating, of political activism and reflection in the Gold Coast. And there we see, and he also situates it and reacts to some of the, you know, more standard post-colonial canon. So I just want to highlight that it's important that it's not some, that we don't see this as something coming from elsewhere, but we appreciate our own tradition of thought in that very vein, which is very old, but it, which of course has been continued by people like Kwesi Wiredu and others, where, especially in African philosophy, but also in applied philosophy, these things have really been championed and expanded. So no, it's certainly not something that is external, and we do not need actually to limit ourselves to the, you know, this was like the Holy Trinity of post-colonial studies as it is being taught in the West, you know, one person from Palestine and two people of Indian descent, that's very fine. And I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but I just want to say there are lots of African and diasporan thinkers that take this up and that have been doing this for more than 150 years.
Thank you, I enjoy your presentation. I do have a broad concern about the idea of post-colonial studies. Colonialism, no doubt, is one of the major historical movements with impact all over the world. But there were also many other great historical movements, such as Reformation, the Transatlantic Slave Trade, World War I, World War II. Did we post-study all of those great historical movements? Did we post-study all of these great historical movements? Post-World War I, post-World War II, post-transatlantic slave trade, post-reformation, and now it's post-colonial stuff.
Okay, responding to the first question. Can we see post-colonial studies as a synthesis, and does post-colonial studies have a centricity? Taking up the point of Chakrabarty that we need to provincialize Europe, I think the idea of post-colonial studies is not to introduce a new centricity which then holds for all cultures, societies, and continents, but to made me recognize that, well, all universal concepts may be applicable in many places, but not in all places. That there may be different cultural traditions which have, well, which have their own place, their own right, but which are not able to grasp the whole world in its complexity. And so, in your terms, I would hope that postcolonial studies would be an endeavor of decentering, of introducing many centers instead of one. And to the second question, you have rightly been pointing out the continuity of neocolonialism to be found in IMF structural adjustment programs. Especially here in Ghana, we have the situation. I mean, I'm sure all of you are aware of it, that in the poultry sector, that basically within a decade, Ghanaian farmers lost their market share, which was in the poultry sector, about 90-95%. It went down to 5-10% just due to imports from the European Union. And when the Ghanaian government, when the Ghanaian parliament actually passed a law, a protectionist law against it, it had to be revoked within a few months on the pressure of the IMF, arguing, look, no, this is not the way to go forward. You need to liberalize. You need to open yourselves to the global economy, because this is how global wealth will be enhanced. Well, I'm sure global wealth has been enhanced, but not the wealth of the Ghanaian poultry farmers. Now, what do we have to counter this? This is a difficult question. I think what has been a major current in the past two decades is what has been described as the rise of the South, the increasing importance of the BRIC state, of the Brazilian, Indian, Chinese, maybe even South African, Russian economy in the world. And this, well, and this brings also some alternatives. Alternatives in the form of the Asian Investment Bank, and alternatives in form of Chinese Development Corporation, in forms of Indian investment. Now, these alternatives, well, one has to be careful, in my opinion, because in a global capitalist economy, well, the Chinese investment are not necessarily more benevolent than the US investments. But at least one has a different standing if one can choose, if there's not a monopoly on investment and development cooperation, which has been the case. So, what do we have to counter? One answer would be one can try to choose from different alternatives. But the other answer, and the answer that would be actually closer to me, would be what do we have to counter? Well, we have to counter the West not by finding ways of becoming like the West, of competing in this race for industrialism, for a higher GDP, for more economic growth, because, well, we all have seen that this race has brought, in ecological terms, the planet to a situation where continuing this race is a threat, where climate change is a threat, where CO2 emissions are a threat, where increasing pollution is a threat, where non-renewable energies are, well, becoming increasingly scarce during the next decades. So, well, basically, coming back to Frantz Fanon, I think the most important thing to counter this would be to look for alternatives within Africa, and to look, okay, well, how can we do it differently, instead of how can we compete in this race for a higher gross national product. Okay, the question of Well, it wasn't actually a question, it was more of a comment. I'm grateful for this comment, and I, although you keep presenting me as your boss, I hope that I can continue to learn a lot from you during the next years. Other historical movements, if we are now in a post-colonial era, aren't we also in a post-World War II era, etc., etc.? I would agree, yes, we are. But I would still maintain that the imprint of the era of colonialism has been more prolonged and has been more influential than maybe the imprint of other historical events, which we also might describe ourselves of being in a post-era in. So, now this is a matter of debate, of course, but I would concede the point that there have been, of course, other historical movements which we should not neglect. We could also describe, if we are dealing with chronological eras, our present contemporary period as being post-Enlightenment, as being post-World War II, as being post-nuclear bombs. All of these issues have been influential. And it is always a question of emphasis if you say a post-colonial era or a post-Enlightenment era.
In terms of the question of name, maybe it goes a bit to Bessie's comment, but there might have been others. In terms of the point of naming and historicizing, yeah, we may call something post-colonial or not. It's about the ingredients of that concept. I'm sure you feel the same way. So whether we look at Spivak, or we look at, let's say, Third World Network. I'm sure Third World Network, being an NGO, you will not find post-colonial in their writings. They are dealing with issues of mining and its effects. But actually, they are theorizing the post-colony, even though we do not see it, you know, fronted in their literature. And I'm sure you've also heard that California is only 5% of their water because of abuse of the earth, and now they are asking people to not water their lawns, and to they are going to think as a state of having new, plants that don't need water or something. But then you wonder what kind of plants are those, and those plants are also related to the environment. And by the way, Spivak is Agri-Fraser Gadgetsberg, or yeah. I can't remember the order. She's our speaker this year, so you should, or in May at some point, so you should make sure that you listen to her. Kaisa, you had your hand up.
I wanted to start the debate, but maybe let's take other comments.
Okay. Those, Professor Sutherland Addy, any other takers? Yes, sir. I'm sorry, I'm blanking out on your name, but you're next in line. A third? Okay, so.
Thank you very much for the presentation. I think that one of the things that we need to recognize is that the person who names something first tends to have some kind of control over that, and this has been happening all over the world from even the beginning of the lecture. You could tell that this is what happened when explorations and so on were going on, and I think it's time for us to more aggressively assert those thought leaders that we know about and those bodies of work, so that they take their place as another center where, you know, the debates can happen on the basis of knowledge, because it's like we don't know, you know, about them. And I want to agree with Kaiser's position that in this university, and I've just attended a number of meetings in which we're looking at curriculum and we're looking at reading lists and so on. And in some of the empirical, you know, areas, in courses where things appear to be more empirical, you know, that the reading list is 99% from outside of our continent, and we're not even putting what we ourselves have been writing on our reading list. So this, for me, it's not a question to the speaker so much as a challenge to us to be far more assertive and to take the trouble to delve into these areas which are not low-hanging fruit, because we haven't really had the opportunity to study them. But we just have to go and find them and bring them up so that we name them as being you know, an alternative body, or even the body, you know, of work to go to.
Thank you, Prof. My name is Emmanuel Amebo. I think it's a very incisive talk, and I enjoyed it very much. But I just, at times, I just wonder whether we are in anything called post-colonialism era, because you look at the advent of slavery, and indeed after the so-called abolition, what happened? The indentured laborers were sent from the Indian subcontinent to the Caribbean to undercut the local people who had been freed, so that although you are free, you are not able to exert any economic influence. You still don't own anything. Your labor is still being dominated. And as we speak, years and hundreds of years ago, black people from Africa were sent to the so-called New World in chains. But at the moment, we see young people fighting to be enslaved through Libya, the Mediterranean, and all those high seas, through the high seas to be enslaved. So I just wonder whether we really, really in any era called post-colonialism. I don't know if you look at the work of John Perkins in his famous book, The Confessions of an Economic Hitman, where these so-called international bodies, the IMF, the World Bank, they deliberately sent officers to go and undermine various governments all over the world. And is it any wonder that in spite of all their loans and whatever the US, we still continue to be dependent on them? Thank you.
Sorry, could you maybe repeat your point? I didn't get the young people fighting to be enslaved.
Exactly. If you look at the currently, we have people who are sailing in boats and being trying to get into what we call Fortress Europe at the moment, where national boundaries have been set and you can't enter. So what they do is get on boats which are very unseaworthy, and they get drowned, and, you know. That's right, yeah.
I would like to insert a notion of caution in this debate, because although these confessions of an economic hitman are very revealing in terms of what is going on in this global economy, I would maintain that basically the exploitation and brutality that takes place there is a different one from the one which took place in the colonial era, in the sense that, well, it is increasingly open to people regardless of their skin color. And this doesn't make it better, third, one has to my mind, one has to be aware that some things changed. That, well, capitalism may still be as brutal as it was in the era of colonialism, but now has become a little bit more diverse, more open for questions of gender, more open for people of a different skin color than the white one. And yet, it is, well, we all know people are dying every day. And not some people, but 30,000 people at least dying each day because of lack of food, lack of medicine, lack of clean water. Although there is actually no scarcity of food or medicine on this world, but it's a matter of individual entitlement. These people are too poor within an economic system that, well, conditions access to medicine or food through the question of money. Now, this is, to be sure, this is a system of mass murder, a structural mass murder. It's not, well, people are being shot by someone with a gun in his hand, but people are dying in another way. And this does function even without the doctrine of white superiority. And this is something where I think we have to be aware of the continuities between colonialism and present-day era, but also of the differences. I mean, the doctrine of the colonial era that non-white people are not able to govern themselves, that they are inferior, well, this is something which few people would maintain nowadays. But still we are faced with the economic inequality, but still we are faced with the fact that the vast, vast majority of the people dying each day in this global capitalism, well, are non-white people. And this has, well, this has something to do with ideas of racism, but it has more to do with ideas of capitalism. And I think we have to think together these, well, the dimensions of repression, without saying, okay, there is only one dimension of repression. We have to realize that there are numerous dimensions of repression, and we also have to realize that those who you say are fighting to be enslaved in now by trying to get across the Mediterranean in nutshells, risking their lives to do what? To be, well, exploited in Fortress Europe. I think we have to grant that, well, they envisage, well, they see no future here on this continent, and they believe they see a future in Europe. And I find it difficult to tell them, well, but actually you are merely fighting to be enslaved. They are actually pursuing their hope for a better life. And I mean, if you look at the European governments, last year we had this initiative by the Italian government saying, okay, now we're not going to let them drown, we're going to try and send our ships out, and they did for a few months. And they saved many lives, but after a few months they said, look, this is costing us this is actually costing us I think with like 9 million euro per month, a tiny amount. And they went to the European Union and said, look, we're now doing the work of collecting these refugees. We want our money. We want you to contribute financially so that we can go on doing it. And the European Union government said, no, this is not worth the price. And so the Italian government, fine, then we stop doing it, then we don't care about the refugees. And people are continuing to drown because the European Union is not willing to pay these 9 million euro or something per month. And it's a scandal. But I would say it's not the same scandal as colonialism, but it's a new scandal. It's a scandal where colonialism has transformed into something else, which is not much nicer nowadays.
Chrissy's hand is up, but we just passed 9:10, 10:30, so we have to bring this to a close. I'm sure that Nkrumah and the spirit of our ancestors will be pleased about the debates that we have had in the room this morning, and that they would want this to feed these arguments and these debates and criticism and interrogation to find their way into the work that we do, and beyond the work that we do into public spaces and into influencing the discourse and thinking of particularly the next generation. So on that note, I want to thank you, Professor Dea, very, very much for this morning's seminar. And I know that hundreds more will benefit from it when we post it on our website and our YouTube channel. So once again, thank you very much. And please join me in showing our appreciation to our speaker.
All right, once again, give yourselves also a round of applause for coming out in your numbers. Next week, we have another presentation by Kofi Ababli, who is a practitioner. He's in journalism, and he will be dealing with Ghana Kassel cartography, and he will be dealing with the words that define our times, new words that come up, such as doomsaw, which is so relevant today, the light off that we suffer from. And he's tracing history through these words. So it should be extremely interesting, especially to those of you who are interested in language such as myself. So again, tell your friends when we send the emails, feel free to forward those, and we'll see you again next week, this same place, same time.